Those unfamiliar with orbital calculations might think that the best way to reach a planet from Earth is to simply wait until it's as close as possible and then point the rocket in its direction and take off. But no, this method would not work for several reasons. The most obvious is that the planets, including Earth, are not motionless in space, but move in almost circular orbits at speeds of tens of kilometers per second. Therefore, instead of aim and shoot, it's necessary to put the spacecraft on an elliptical orbit called a Hohmann transfer orbit that connects Earth to where the planet will be by the time the spacecraft reaches the planet's orbit. This, however, poses definite launch dates. The actual travel time will be given by half the time it takes to travel the entire Hohmann orbit, which is a value easily calculated through Kepler's third law. Let us take the example of Mars. The transfer orbit from Earth to Mars, an ellipse whose major axis is equal to the sum of the semi-axis of the orbits of the two planets involved, can be accomplished in less than 17 months, which means that the trip to Mars with this system would take about 8.5 months. Note that the Hohmann transfer orbit only fires the rocket motor twice, once to leave Earth's orbit and once to match the speed and go into orbit with the destination.
Do you ever get the feeling that you are being listened to over your digital devices? Don't worry, we've got you covered. Introducing NordVPN, your number one choice for security. With its new upgrades, you can create successful integration. NordVPN provides the most transparent VPN online. It changes your IP address and channels your traffic through an encrypted tunnel, making you fully anonymous. Here at NordVPN, we tend to be creative, authentic, and informative. It is highly easy to use and functions with high speed over 55,000 plus servers on up to 6 devices in 60 countries. NordVPN also brought crazy offers for its techies, featuring diskless service, store no data or configurations on site, automatic kill switch, double VPN for extra protection, NordLynx, a next generation VPN tunneling solution. If you want to see your favorite content online, but no such platform is available in your country, then just switch your virtual location. It's that simple. Just change your VPN location and watch Peaky Blinders' new season, available only in the UK in BBC Player. We brought an insane offer for our insane curiosity viewers. Get exclusive NordVPN deal today at nordvpn.com/curiosity. It's totally risk-free with Nord's 30-day money-back guarantee. We also provide 24/7 live chat customer support. You can check out our other cybersecurity apps like NordPass and NordLocker. Get total security and make your VPN experience truly your own with NordVPN.
Could we go faster? Sure, but we would have to carry a lot of extra fuel, which would also mean increasing the speed at launch. Basically, a dog biting its own tail. Beyond that, we have to consider that the duration of the trip also depends on the kind of encounter we want to have with the planet. There is indeed a lot of difference between arrival with orbital insertion and arrival with a fast flyover. In the former case, the departure speed will have to be slowed down near arrival to facilitate orbital insertion, and this will mean carrying and burning a lot of fuel and lengthening the travel time. On the other hand, the departure speed can be preserved until the end, without slowing down. This is why, as we're about to see, some missions to Jupiter have turned out to be very fast and others very slow. The second discriminator in interplanetary flight is the distance between inner and outer planets. Strange as it may seem, going toward the Sun by being attracted by its strong gravity is not an advantage at all. It's fine only if you're content to do a fast flyover. But if you want to orbit a planet like Mercury or Venus, you have only two options: braking with retro rockets to counteract the Sun's gravity, or losing speed by doing flybys with neighboring planets. In the former case, you will need a huge amount of fuel, and in the latter, the travel times and distances will be stretched out of proportion. The same thing happens with the outer planets, but in reverse. Indeed, in this case, one must overcome the Sun's gravity, which tends to slow down the probe, and flybys with other planets serve to acquire more energy and thus more speed. These we have just laid out are the general principles of interplanetary navigation. But what if we found out the times, velocities, and trajectories used to get to each of the planets in the solar system? Let's begin our countdown. Number 7. Mercury. Distance from the Sun, 58 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 91 million kilometers. For the reasons already stated, of all the planets to make up our solar system, it is perhaps the most complicated to reach, despite being decidedly close to Earth. Even to reach this small planet, in fact, it will be necessary to follow the Hohmann orbit, which in this case will be about 310 million kilometers long. This distance could be covered in just 106 days, but we would be flying over the planet at a speed of 58 kilometers per second, which is more than 200,000 kilometers per hour, which would mean we would only have a few minutes to survey the case. We would be a bullet in space. In 1974, Mariner 10 was the first probe to make the flyover, but first slowed its speed so that it would have more time for photographic shots. It still made the trip in 133 days. Much slower were the probes that had as their target to embed themselves in an orbit around the planet, and they were forced to try to lose speed by first encountering other planets, such as Bepi Colombo, which left in 2018 and will enter Mercury orbit in 2025 after a flyby of Earth, two of Venus and three of Mercury. Performing gravitational slingshot maneuvers on such occasions will reduce fuel consumption, making it lower overall than that required for a direct route from Earth to Mercury, which is faster and more expensive. Number 6. Venus. Distance from the Sun, 128 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 41 million kilometers. Despite its great proximity to Earth, the Hohmann orbit for Venus also involves a very long route of a whopping 402 million kilometers, a distance that an average probe could travel in less than 150 days. The first mission to be directed to Venus was Venera 1 in 1961. The Soviet probe launched at full power and reached Venus in 97 days. However, it performed a flyby at too high a speed and then got lost in orbit around the Sun. The following year, NASA's Mariner 2 probe also flew over the planet, but more cautiously, taking 115 days. In 1990, NASA's Magellan entered Venus orbit after a journey of a whopping 463 days, penalized by the use of a reduced power engine following program cancellations after the 1986 Shuttle Challenger disaster. In 2006, ESA's Venus Express reached Venus orbit in 153 days, using the main engine to reduce speed so it could be caught in Venusian gravity. Number 5. Mars. Distance from the Sun, 228 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 56 million kilometers. As we've already seen, with the technology we currently possess, reaching Mars would require a journey lasting about 8 months, which is necessary to cover the Hohmann orbital path, which for the red planet is almost 600 million kilometers, a dozen times longer than the minimum distance to Earth. The first missions, which only had to fly over the planet and quickly take a few photographs, were launched on a direct path, obviously taking much less time. The first NASA probes, Mariner 6 and 7, arrived at the flyby with Mars after 156 and 131 days respectively. The slower and heavier missions, such as the 1976 Viking missions, took twice as long, about 300 days to enter orbit around the planet. The last major mission, the one that laid the Perseverance rover on the sands of Mars, remained average, taking 203 days. Number 4. Jupiter. Distance from the Sun, 778 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 620 million kilometers. Even in the case of the giant of the solar system, space missions have had very different timelines. The first probe to reach Jupiter was Pioneer 10, which left on March 3, 1972, and arrived at its destination on the 3rd of December, 1973, after 640 days of flight, not even a two-year journey. It was, in fact, a simple flyover, with a probe traveling the 1.2 billion kilometers of Hohmann's orbit without ever slowing down. Later, in the late 1970s, the Voyager 1 and 2 probes also made a close pass of the planet, taking as little as 550 days of travel. The Galileo probe, on the other hand, was the first to attempt to enter orbit, and it took a whopping 2,242 days to do so. In fact, after leaving in 1989, it had to make two gravitational flyovers of Earth and one of Venus to pick up the considerable initial velocity and then decelerate enough to succeed in entering a stationary orbit around Jupiter in 1995, after more than 6 years. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel and click the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Number 3. Saturn. Distance from the Sun, 1,427 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 1,277 million kilometers. Pioneer 11 was the second space mission after Pioneer 10 to reach Jupiter and the first to fly over Saturn. After Mariner 10, it was the second probe ever to make use of a gravity assist. In fact, thanks to its encounter with Jupiter, it increased its speed and succeeded in 1979 in reaching and passing Saturn. The journey lasted 2,340 days, almost 6.5 years. In November 1980, it was the turn of Voyager 1, also accelerated by the previous encounter with Jupiter to fly over Saturn, and it succeeded in the record time of 1,165 days, or just over 3 years. In contrast, its twin Voyager 2 took over 4 years. In 1997, it was Cassini's turn to be launched towards Saturn. Unlike the others, it availed itself of a very complicated orbit, which led it to have gravity assist with Venus, Earth, and Jupiter. This enabled it to make the journey in 2,452 days, or 6.7 years, despite minimal fuel consumption. Number 2. Uranus. Distance from the Sun, 2,870 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 2,720 million kilometers. So far, only one mission has reached the seventh planet in the solar system, Voyager 2, which took only 8.5 years to get to fly over the gas giant. It should be noted that the expected time to make the Earth-Uranus path following the Hohmann orbit is 16 years. Only thanks to making gravitational assists with Jupiter and Saturn, Voyager 2 was able to almost halve it. Number 1. Neptune. Distance from the Sun, 4,500 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 4,347 million kilometers. The last planet in the solar system has also been reached so far by only one probe. Again, the legendary Voyager 2, which after its encounter with Uranus, flew over Neptune in 1989, taking 12.5 years to make the entire journey starting from Earth. Without the gravitational assists following Hohmann's orbit, the journey would have taken more than 30 years instead. Pluto. Distance from the Sun, 5,900 million kilometers. Minimum distance from Earth, 4,300 million kilometers. Okay, we all know that Pluto is no longer considered a planet, but we can't leave it aside since the latest and deepest mission, New Horizons, was dedicated precisely to its exploration. Launched in January 2006, and with a speed of over 58,000 kilometers per hour, it was the fastest man-made object to leave Earth so far. So fast that it took only 374 days to reach Jupiter, from which it had a gravity assist and an increase in speed. Thanks to all this, and despite Hohmann's orbit for Pluto predicting a travel time of 45 years, the New Horizons arrived at the most famous of the dwarf planets in just 9.5 years. This goes to show how space navigation is only a matter of acceleration and speed. Of course, the propulsion systems capable of getting us to even the most distant planets in just a month's journey are already being studied for the near future. We just have to wait and trust. And for that matter, do you have anything better to do?